This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. Romanian victory, collapse of the Hungarian Soviet Republic, belligerence. Constantine Prezan Ion Antonescu, strength 10,000-80,000, 10,000-96,000 casualties and losses unknown, dead approximately 41,000, captured 3,670 dead, 11,666 total. The Hungarian-Romanian War was fought between the First Hungarian Republic, succeeded by the Hungarian Soviet Republic, and the Kingdom of Romania from November 1918 until March 1920, with the main military operations starting in April and ending in August 1919. At the end of 1918, the final year of World War I, the collapse of Austria-Hungary led to the declaration of Union of Transylvania with Romania. The Romanians wanted to ensure the success of their territorial demands in the coming peace conference and to help the national aspirations of the Transylvanian Romanians. The Crown Council in Bucharest decided in favor of an attack, and in April 1919 the Romanians launched a powerful offensive along the entire Hungarian-Romanian demarcation line, which was set according to the Belgrade Armistice of 1918. The Paris Conference decisions of moving forward the Hungarian-Romanian demarcation line was unacceptable to the Hungarian government, which resigned in March 1919. The Bolsheviks took power and wanted to make good on their promise to protect Hungary's borders, withstanding the Entente's further demand of territorial concessions. During the war, the Hungarian Red Army also fought against troops from Czechoslovakia, though not simultaneously with the Romanians, and Yugoslavian forces occupied Hungary up to Pécs. In the war's first phase, the Romanian army advanced against light resistance up to the western Carpathian Mountains. In the second phase, they overcame the Hungarian Red Army to reach the Tisza River. Finally, in the third phase, they defeated the Hungarian army and ousted the communist regime of Béla Kun. After they occupied Budapest, August 1919. Contents 1. Background 11. Hungary 12. Romania 13. Outline of the War 2. Phase 1, November 1918 to March 1919. 3. Phase 2, April 1919 to June 1919. 31. The Hungarian attack. 32. The fate of the CK Division. 33. The Romanian army reaches the Tisza Line. 34. The Hungarian attack on Czechoslovakia. 341. Strengthening the Hungarian army. 342. Military operations. A Romanian perspective. 343. Aftermath. 35. Involvement of Bolshevik Russia. 351. A Hungarian perspective. 352. Military operations in Bessarabia in 1919. 4. Phase 3, July 1919 to August 1919. 41. The opposing forces. 42. The Hungarian attack. 421. Fighting on the flanks. 422. Fighting in the center. 43. The Romanian counterattack. 44. The Romanians cross the Tisza. 45. The debacle of the Hungarian army. 46. The Romanians occupy Budapest. 47. Casualties, prisoners and war booty. 5. Aftermath. 51. Reparations or looting. 52. Epilogue. 6. Order of battle. 7. See also. 8. References. 9. Bibliography. Background. Territorial changes in the war between Hungary and Romania. Hungary in 1918. The Austro-Hungarian monarchy collapsed as a result of losing World War I on October 31, 1918. The success of the Aster Revolution in Budapest brought the left-liberal Count Mihály Károly, an Entente devotee, to power as Prime Minister. He yielded to Woodrow Wilson's pacifism by ordering the full disarmament of the Hungarian army and proclaimed the advent of the First Republic, of which he was president on 13 November 1918 in Belgrade. Károly signed an armistice with the Entente, setting up demarcation lines for the territory that was to remain under Hungarian control until definitive frontiers would be established. By the terms of the armistice, Serbian and French troops advanced from the south, taking control of the entire Banat and Croatia. At the same time, Czechoslovakia took control of Upper Hungary and of Carpathian Ruthenia, and Romanian troops were allowed to advance to the Mureș River. However, the demarcation lines were not to hold for long, the Serbians occupying Pécs as soon as November 14. The armistice limited the size of the Hungarian army to 6 infantry and 2 cavalry divisions. By February 1919, the Károly government had lost all popular support, having failed on domestic and military fronts. The communist leader Béla Kun was imprisoned in the Marco Street prison. On February, after the resign of the liberal Mihály Károly, Kun was released from the prison. Kun immediately formed a social democrat and communist coalition government on March 21, and proclaimed the Hungarian Soviet Republic on the same same day, however some days later the Communists purged the Social Democrats from the government. The new government proclaimed the Hungarian Soviet Republic and promised equality and social justice. The Hungarian Soviet government proposed that Hungary be restructured as a federation. The proposal was intended to appeal to both domestic and foreign opinion. Domestic considerations included maintaining the territorial integrity and economic unity of the former Crown lands and protecting the nation's borders via a patriotic war. The government had popular support, especially from the army. Most of the officers of the Hungarian army originated from areas that had been forcibly occupied by states bordering Hungary, and this circumstance heightened its patriotic mood in light of President Wilson's doctrine of self-determination of peoples. The proposed federation was also intended to appeal to foreign opinion as a solution to the country's multi-ethnic composition. The dominance of Hungary's Magyars would be lessened by allowing self-government and self-directed institutions for the non-Magyar peoples of Hungary. The Communists, or Reds, came to power largely thanks to being the only group with an organized fighting force, and to their promising that Hungary would defend its territory without conscription, possibly with the help of the Soviet Red Army initially. Most soldiers of Hungary's Red Army were armed factory workers from Budapest. Later, the Hungarian Red Army became a truly national army, the ranks of which were motivated by patriotism rather than ideology. Romania main article, Romania during World War I. In 1916, Romania entered World War I on the side of the Entente, with the main goal of uniting all territories with a Romanian national majority into one state. See Treaty of Bucharest 1916. In 1918, after the Communists took power in Russia and signed a separate peace in the Treaty of Brest-Litovsk with the Central Powers, Romania was left alone on the Entente's Eastern Front, a situation that far surpassed its military capabilities. Therefore, it sued for peace, and reached an understanding with the Central Powers in May 1918 in the Treaty of Bucharest. Alexandru Margoloman signed the Treaty of Bucharest with the Central Powers on May 7, 1918. However, this treaty was never signed by King Ferdinand. The situation in Romania at the end of 1918 was dire. Romania was suffering from the consequences of the punitive war reparations imposed by the Central Powers. Dobruja was under Bulgarian occupation, and a large German army under the command of Field Marshal August von Mackensen was retreating through the country. The bulk of the Romanian army was demobilized, leaving only 4 full-strength divisions, while further 8 divisions were at peacetime strength. With these troops, the army had to keep the order and protect Bessarabia from hostile actions of the Soviet Union, for which purpose it used the 4 battle-able divisions, while at the same time counter the Bulgarian presence in Dobrogea and supervise the retreating German forces. On 10 November 1918, taking advantage of the Central Powers' precarious situation, Romania re-entered the war on the side of the Entente with the same objectives as in 1916. King Ferdinand called for the mobilization of the Romanian army and ordered it to attack over the Carpathian Mountains into Transylvania. The end of World War I that followed very soon did not bring the end of fighting for the Romanian army. The fighting continued later that year and into 1919 during the Hungarian-Romanian War. Outline of the war. The war is divided here into 3 phases, mirroring the main operations of the Romanian army in the war's first phase. The Romanian army advanced up to the western Carpathian Mountains in the second phase. After the Communists took power in Hungary, the Romanian army overcame the Hungarian Red Army to reach the Tisza River. Finally, in the third phase, the Romanian army destroyed the Hungarian army and occupied Budapest, ousting the communist regime of Béla Kun. Phase 1, November 1918 to March 1919. Main article, Union of Transylvania with Romania. Romanian crossing at Prisicani and Palanca, part of Hungarian-Romanian War. Date 13 November 1918. Location, Transylvania, now part of Romania. Result, beginning of the Hungarian-Romanian War. Belligerents, Kingdom of Hungary. In December 1918, Romanian army units reached the line of the Mureș River, which was the demarcation line agreed upon by the representatives of the Entente and of Hungary in Belgrade on November 13, 1918. At the same time, units of the German army, under the command of Marshal von Mackensen, retreated westward following a Romanian request. The Allied command in the east, under the leadership of the French general Franchet Despere, allowed the Romanian army to advance up to the line of the Western Carpathians. The 7th Vanatory Division advanced in the direction of Cluj, and the first in the direction of Alba Iulia on December 24. Units of the Romanian Army entered Cluj by January 22, 1919. The Romanian Army controlled the entire territory up to this demarcation line. At this point, the Romanian Army in Transylvania was stretched thin, having to simultaneously deter the Hungarian Army and maintain order in the territories under its control. Hence, the Romanian High Command decided to send two more divisions into Transylvania, the 2nd Vanatory Division to Sibiu, and the 6th Infantry Division to Brasov. A unified command of the Romanian Army in Transylvania was also established, with the headquarters at Sibiu. General Traian Mosoiu was put in charge of this command. Romania started organizing the territory it had taken, which at this point was far from encompassing the ethnic Romanian population in the region. Two new infantry divisions, the 16th and the 18th, were organized from Romanian soldiers previously mobilized in the Austro-Hungarian Army on February 28. The Allied Council decided to notify Hungary of the new demarcation line to which the Romanian Army would advance. This line coincided with the railways connecting the cities of Satu Mare, Oradea and Arad. However, the Romanian Army was not allowed to enter these cities. A demilitarized zone was to be created, stretching from there up to 5. Romanian delegation at the peace conference in Paris requested that the Romanian army be allowed to oust the Hungarian communists from power. Although well aware of the communist danger, the Allied Council was marked by dissension between the U.S. President Woodrow Wilson, the British Prime Minister David Lloyd George, and the French Prime Minister Georges Clemenceau about the guarantees required by France for its borders with Germany in particular. The American delegation was convinced that French hardliners around Marshal Foch were trying to initiate a new conflict that would eventually lead to a new war, this time against Germany and the Soviet Union. Acting on these premises, the participants at the conference tried to defuse the situation in Hungary. Hence, the South African General Smuts was sent to Budapest on April 4 with a proposition for the Kun government to abide by the conditions previously presented to Károly. This action of the Allies also amounted to recognizing Communist Hungary in exchange for fulfilling the conditions in the VIX note. The Allied powers would lift the blockade of Hungary and adopt a benevolent attitude towards it in the question of the territories it had to yield to Romania, Czechoslovakia and Yugoslavia. Kun, however, asked that the Romanian army be ordered back to the line of the Mureș River, and the discussion stalled. Meanwhile, Kun sought to gain time in order to be able to build up a military force capable of waging war with Romania and Czechoslovakia on the Romanian front. There were some 20,000 troops in the first line facing the Romanian army. Kun managed to mobilize another 60,000 in the second line by the use of recruitment centers in Oradea, Gaiula, Debrecen, and Szolnok, among others. This Hungarian army was a mix of some elite units and officers from the former Austro-Hungarian army, and poor quality volunteers. They were equipped with some 137 cannons and 5 armored trains. Although a colorful mix, this army was held together by nationalist rather than communist ideals, and was therefore highly motivated. Kun hoped also that the Soviet Union would come to its help and attack Romania from the east once the discussions with Kun stalled. The Romanian army was ordered by the Romanian government to take action and force the Hungarian authorities to comply with the Allied Council decision on February 28 concerning the new demarcation line. The Romanian army in Transylvania comprised 64 infantry battalions, 28 cavalry squadrons, 160 cannons, 32 howitzers, 1 armored train, 3 air squadrons, 2 pioneer battalions, organized into 2 groups, north and south. The overall command of the Romanian army in Transylvania was entrusted to General George Martirescu, while General Mosoiu was appointed commander of the northern group. The Romanian battle plan was to strike with the more powerful northern group and take Carai and Oradea, thus separating the elite CK division from the rest of the Hungarian army. Made primarily of volunteers, then the group should proceed with the flanking of the Hungarian army. At the same time, the southern group would advance only up to Rodna and Bias, and then serve as pivot for the flanking maneuver of the northern group. The overall advance was to stop only at the Tisza River. The start of the offensive was planned for April 16. The Hungarian attack operations of the Romanian army in the second phase of the Hungarian-Romanian War. The demilitarized zone proposed by the Allied Council on 28 February is shown in grey. Aware of the Romanian preparations, the Hungarians fortified the mountain passes in their possession and launched a preemptive attack on the night between April 15 and 16. The attack was stopped with the help of the reserve formations and the Romanians' defensive lines held between April 16 16 and 18, the Romanians started their own offensive, forcing the mountain passes after heavy fighting on the front of the 2nd Vanatory Division. A battalion of Hungarian cadets offered heavy resistance, and was defeated by the Romanian 9th Regiment only towards the evening of April 16. On April 18, the first phase of the Romanian offensive was over, and the Hungarian front was broken. Carai was taken by the Romanian troops on April 19, Oradea and Salanta on April 20. At this moment, the Romanian army reached the line set by the Allies in the VIX note. However, the Romanian High Command decided to go over this line and advance to the Tisza River. For military reasons, the Tisza makes a natural obstacle that is easy to defend, and at the same time the Hungarian army was beaten but not destroyed. By doing so, the Romanians went against the wishes of the Allies. The fate of the CK division. This section does not cite any sources. Please help improve this section by adding citations to reliable sources. Unsourced material may be challenged and removed. March 2012. Learn how and when to remove this template. Message making use of their cavalry. The Romanians hindered any attempts by the Hungarian army to set a new defensive line between Nerejahaza, Debrecen and Békéscsaba at the same time on the front of the northern group. The best unit of the Hungarian army, the CK division under the command of Colonel Kratikvil, was retreating towards Nerejahaza, being constantly harassed by the Romanian troops, mainly from the 2nd Cavalry Division. Citation needed. They tried to stop their retreat and fight around the city, but were dislodged by the Romanians, and Nerejahaza was occupied on April 26. The division tried to flee west over Tisza, but by this time the entire eastern bank of the river was controlled by the Romanians. The last Hungarian troops defending a bridgehead over the river being defeated on April 29 at Rakamaz with their retreat route cut. The CK division capitulated. On April 29, the Romanian army reaches the Tisza line, the front line between the Hungarian and Romanian armies. On the 3rd of May 1919, Debrecen was occupied by the Romanians on the 23rd of April, and the Romanian army started preparing for the assault on Békéscsaba. This began on the 25th of April, and on the 26th of April, the city fell after some heavy fighting. Most of the remains of the Hungarian army converged towards Szolnok, where they tried to escape west over Tisza, establishing two concentric defense lines around Szolnok, whose ends lay on the Tisza. Between the 29th of April and the 1st of May, the Romanian army managed to break through these lines, despite the reinforcements sent from the west bank of the Tisza. On the evening of the 1st of May 1919, the entire east bank of the Tisza was controlled by the Romanian army. On the 2nd of May, the Kun government sued for peace in the peace proposition sent through Lieutenant Colonel Wirth. Kun was ready to recognize all territorial demands of the Romanians and asked in exchange for a cessation of hostilities and no intervention in the internal Hungarian affairs. The Romanians offered only an armistice, and this only under pressure from the Allied Supreme Command, as on the 30th of April the French Foreign Minister Pichon had summoned the Romanian representative at the peace conference, Prime Minister Bradianu, and asked him to stop the advance of the Romanian troops on the Tisza River and eventually retreat on the demarcation line imposed by the Allies. Bradianu promised that the Romanian troops would not cross the Tisza and would remain on the east bank of the river. Gen Mosoiu was named governor of the military district between the Romanian frontier and the Tisza River, being replaced at the command of the Norther Group by Gen Mihaiescu at the same time. The Romanian 7th Division was transported from the Hungarian front to the Russian front in northern Moldavia. The Hungarian attack on Czechoslovakia. This section does not cite any sources. Please help improve this section by adding citations to reliable sources. Unsourced material may be challenged and removed. March 2012. Learn how and when to remove this template. Message military operations in the Kingdom of Hungary, May-August 1919. Serbia. By attacking Czechoslovak troops, he tried to gain support from within Hungary, by making good on his promise to restore Hungary's borders. Kun also sought to establish a link to his Bolshevik allies in Russia. Internationally, he argued that he acted on the belief that granting the territory where Hungarians were an ethnic majority to the newly formed Czechoslovakia following World War I was unjust, strengthening the Hungarian army. This section does not cite any sources. Please help improve this section by adding citations to reliable sources. Unsourced material may be challenged and removed. March 2012. Learn how and when to remove this template. Message to strengthen the army. Kun's regime recruited heavily from the male population between 19 and 25 years of age in the areas left under his control. Also, many workers, mainly from the Budapest industrial area, joined the army. He also enlisted many former Austro-Hungarian officers, who joined the army out of patriotic rather than ideological reasons. For the offensive in Upper Hungary, today's Slovakia, the Hungarian Austrians concentrated two divisions, the 1st and the 5th, totaling 40 battalions with plenty of artillery military operations. A Romanian perspective. This section does not cite any sources. Please help improve this section by adding citations to reliable sources. Unsourced material may be challenged and removed. March 2012. Learn how and when to remove this template. Message on the 20th of May. The Hungarians, under the lead of Colonel Aurel Stromfeld, attacked in force and routed the Czechoslovak troops in Miskolc. The Romanian command tried to hold the link to the Czechoslovak army and attacked the Hungarian flank with some troops from the 16th Infantry Division and the 2nd Vanatory Division. However, this action was to no avail and it could not stop the rout of the Czechoslovak army. The Romanians retreated to their bridgehead at Tokaj and defended their position against Hungarian attacks between 25 and 30 May. The Hungarian attack against the Czechoslovak army evolved well and consequently the Romanian troops in the north were in danger of being outflanked. Citation needed. On 3 June, the Romanians were thus forced to retreat from Tokaj on the east bank of Tisza, destroying all bridges over the river in the process and breaking any contact with the Hungarian troops to deal with the danger of being outflanked and hinder the communication between the Hungarians and the Soviets. The Romanian troops along Tisza extended their defense line further north and linked with the troops of the Romanian 8th Division, which since 22 May had advanced from Bukovina to meet them. Citation needed. Aftermath. This section does not cite any sources. Please help improve this section by adding citations to reliable sources. Unsourced material may be challenged and removed. March 2012. Learn how and when to remove this template. Message. The success of their attack on the newly forming Czechoslovak state allowed the Hungarian Reds, besides regaining Upper Hungary, to also create a puppet Slovak Soviet Republic. Citation needed. At the end of the operations, the Hungarian army had reached the old frontiers in the northeastern Carpathians in the northwest. The campaign reoccupied important industrial regions around Miskolc, Salgótarján and Selmecbánya. They also started to plan to march against the Romanian army in the east. Involvement of Bolshevik Russia. This section does not cite any sources. Please help improve this section by adding citations to reliable sources. Unsourced material may be challenged and removed. March 2012. Learn how and when to remove this template. Message on the 9th of April 1918. Bessarabia united with Romania. The Unification Act that brought these old Romanian lands within the modern Romanian state was not recognized by the Bolshevik Russia, and later it was challenged by the Soviet Union as unlawful, having to fight the Whites, the Poles, the Ukrainians, and later an Allied invasion in that region. The Red Army had no resources available to seriously threaten Romania at that time. The Russian hopes to use Otaman Grigoriev for an expedition against Romania were shattered after much procrastination and later refusal of the rogue general. Furthermore, numerous peasant uprisings took place near Kiev before the communist takeover in Hungary. The Bolsheviks used the Odessa Soviet Republic as a buffer state to invade Romania, which only turned into several sporadic attacks over the Dniester River in order to reclaim the territory of the former Bessarabia Governorate. A somewhat similar role was taken later by the Moldavian Autonomous Soviet Socialist Republic, which covered roughly the territory of the present-day Transnistria. During that period of time, the Romanian army was being reorganized and such attacks were more or less successful. However, they were always met with force by the Romanian troops stationed in Bessarabia, which managed on all occasions to throw the Bolsheviks back over the Dniester. See Iona Yacher. After the Treaty of Brest-Litovsk, the Soviet forces were pushed out of neighboring Ukraine eastward and until late 1918 were no longer a threat. The situation changed in the beginning of 1919 with the Soviets intensifying their actions, but however great their scope, the means they were using were arguably rather limited. After the end of May, the Soviets scaled down their involvement and brought it to a practical stop. A Hungarian perspective. This section does not cite any sources. Please help improve this section by adding citations to reliable sources. Unsourced material may be challenged and removed. March 2012. Learn how and when to remove this template. Message. After coming to power, the Hungarian Reds had high hopes that Soviet Union would help them by attacking Romania in Bessarabia. Indeed, the Soviets applied pressure on Romania at the political level to the best of their abilities, issuing ultimatums and threatening with war to some extent. The Red Army tried also to fulfill such expectations, but what it did never amounted to a threat big enough to have a serious impact on Romanians' military operations against Communist Hungary. The most notable achievement was the transfer of one Romanian division from the Hungarian front to Bessarabia. Also, some newly formed Romanian formations were sent to Bessarabia to face the Soviet Red Army rather than in Transylvania to face the Hungarian Red Army. Military operations in Bessarabia in 1919. This section does not cite any sources. Please help improve this section objection by adding citations to reliable sources. Unsourced material may be challenged and removed. March 2012 Learn how and when to remove. This template message. A major attack took place at the end of January 1919, when the Bolsheviks pushing the Ukrainian army towards Zeebrugge managed to take control of the Romanian city of Cotin. They held the city for a few days before being routed by the Romanian army after that. Starting February 1919, enough Romanian troops were present in Bessarabia to thwart most attack attempts. The situation was further eased by the fact that the Bolsheviks lacked the resources to seriously threaten Bessarabia at that moment. They had to deal with the advancing armed forces of South Russia led by Anton Denikin. Furthermore, a French-Greek army of 5 divisions, 3 French and 2 Greek under the command of the French general D'Anselmi and with support from some Polish, Ukrainian and Russian volunteers, attacked near Odessa in western Crimea. All these events led to a calm down of the situation in Bessarabia over most of the next 2 months. In support of the Allied attack, Romanian troops of the 39th Regiment occupied Tiraspol on 21 March. Fighting at the same time in Transylvania, the Romanian army could not provide more soldiers in April. However, the army under General D'Anselmi was defeated at Berzov by the Soviet Third Army and forced to retreat towards Odessa. With the change of government in France, the Allied forces were ordered to withdraw from Odessa later that month. Most of the Entente forces retreated by ship, abandoning part of their heavy equipment. Some troops, together with their Russian and Ukrainian allies, retreated through southern Bessarabia at the same time. The Romanian army started fortifying its positions in Bessarabia in preparation of a possible Bolshevik large-scale attack on 1 May. The Russian Bolshevik Foreign Minister Georgi Chicherin issued an ultimatum to the Romanian government, asking it to evacuate Bessarabia and threatening with the use of force in case of non-compliance. At the same time, more Bolshevik troops were concentrating along the Dniester. Anatoliy Ovzienko planned for a massive charge on May 10, 1919. By this they tried to ease the pressure against the Hungarian Bolsheviks, forcing the Romanian army to prepare for an attack in the east. This is why the Romanians brought the 7th Division as reinforcement from the Tisza front into Bessarabia after the ultimatum. The attacks on the Romanian troops in Bessarabia intensified, peaking on 27-28 May when a few hundreds of Bolshevik troops attacked Tyina. In preparation of this attack, they threw manifestos out of a plane, inviting the Allied troops to fraternize with them. However, only 60 French soldiers switched sides and supported the Russians crossing the Dniester. The Bolsheviks managed to enter Tyina, but were repulsed later that day by the Romanians with the help of some French troops in town. To counter the Bolshevik threat, 2 more Romanian divisions were sent into the area, the 4th and the 5th Infantry Divisions. Furthermore, a territorial command was organized in southern Bessarabia, consisting mainly of the 15th Infantry Division. Starting from the end of June, the situation calmed down in Bessarabia. Phase 3, July 1919 to August 1919. The Allied Council was deeply displeased by the Romanian advance to the Tisza without Allied approval. There were even voices blaming the Romanians for the troubles in Hungary and asking for an immediate retreat to the original demarcation line. Concomitantly with a downsize of the Romanian army, the Council tried also to persuade the Romanians to start talks with the Kun government. However, the Romanian government stood by its decision, and argued that the Tisza line was the sole military meaningful demarcation line until the final border line between Romania and Hungary was established and internationally recognized. The Council put pressure on Kun to stop its advances into Czechoslovakia, under the threat of a coordinated attack of the French, Serb and Romanian troops from the south and the east respectively. They also promised a favorable attitude towards Soviet Hungary in the peace talks to follow, and in delineating Hungary's new borders on 12 June. These borders were brought to the attention of the governments of Romania, Czechoslovakia, Yugoslavia and Hungary. Under these circumstances, Hungary signed an armistice with Czechoslovakia on 23 June, and by July 4, the Hungarian troops retreated 15. Demobilized upon hearing the Romanian demands from the council representatives, Kun answered that from now on he would rely solely on the might of his army. This new turn of events swung the council against Kun, and on the 11th of July it decided to start a coordinated attack of the Serb, French and Romanian troops against Soviet Hungary. The planning for this attack was entrusted to Marshal Foch. However, immediately after the Czechoslovak armistice, as Romania was unwilling to withdraw its army from eastern Hungary, Kun ordered military operations against the Romanian troops, Hungary started to mobilize its army against the Romanians along Tisza, and on 17 July the Hungarians were the first to strike the opposing forces. This section does not cite any sources. Please help improve this section by adding citations to reliable sources. Unsourced material may be challenged and removed. March 2012. Learn how and when to remove this template message. The Romanians were facing the Hungarians on a front of some 250. River had greatly improved. It was better organized and equipped, and it had a high morale as it fought for its motherland. The morale was further boosted by the successes against the Czechoslovak army. The communists held control of the army command through their political commissaries, but they were supported by experienced professional officers at division level and below. Mostly professional officers were in command. The Hungarians mustered 100 infantry battalions, with some 50,000 men, 10 cavalry squadrons with 1,365 men, 69 artillery batteries of calibers ranging up to 305. Around Békéscsaba, the third line included the most powerful Romanian formations and had to be used as maneuvering mass. It was composed of the 1st and 6th Infantry Divisions, 1st and 2nd Cavalry Divisions, as well as some support units. These troops took positions along the railway link stretching from Kurei, through Oradea, up to north of Arad. The 20th and the 21st Infantry Divisions were tasked with maintaining the security and public order behind the third line. The first line was rather thin, as it was supposed to fight delay actions until the true intentions of the attacking Hungarians were revealed. After that, together with the troops in the second line, they were to hold the attackers until the counterattack of the troops in the third line could commence. For such maneuvering actions, the Romanian command planned to make use of the railway links under their control and had prepared a sufficient number of trains for that purpose. The Romanians were also highly motivated, fighting for their dream to unify into a single country all the lands inhabited by ethnic Romanians. This long-yearned-for dream was now supported by Woodrow Wilson's principles of self-determination and nation-state. In addition, most of her soldiers were experienced World War I veterans. The Hungarian attack. This section does not cite any sources. Please help improve this section by adding citations to reliable sources. Unsourced material may be challenged and removed. March 2012. Learn how and when to remove this template message. Operations of the Hungarian and Romanian armies during the Battle of the Tisza River. In the third phase of the Hungarian-Romanian War between the 17th and the 20th of July, the Hungarians bombarded the Romanian positions and conducted reconnaissance operations on the 20th of July, around 3 a.m. After a violent bombardment, the Hungarian infantry of all three groups crossed the Tisza and attacked the Romanian positions fighting on the flanks. This section does not cite any sources. Please help improve this section by adding citations to reliable sources. Unsourced material may be challenged and removed. March 2012. Learn how and when to remove this template message. In the north, on the 20th of July, the Hungarians took Rakamaz and some villages around it. Troops of the Romanian 16th Division took back the villages but only managed to retake Rakamaz the next day. With the help of the 2nd Vanatori Division, however, the Hungarians renewed their efforts and, supported by their artillery, retook Rakamaz and two villages around it, but could not break out of the bridgehead. Therefore, they tried to outflank the Romanian positions and cross the Tisza further south at Tiszafjord with troops of the 80th International Brigade, but they were stopped there by troops of the Romanian 16th Division. The Romanians also brought forward some troops of the 20th Infantry Division into this combat and managed to clear the bridgehead at Tiszafjord on the 24th of July. Not being able to break out of Rakamaz, the Hungarians started fortifying their positions and redeployed some troops elsewhere. There was a lull in fighting in the north, as the Romanians followed suit only on 26. Section by adding citations to reliable sources. Unsourced material may be challenged and removed. March 2012. Learn how and when to remove this template message. On the 20th of July, the Hungarians managed to establish a solid bridgehead on the east bank of the Tisza across Zolnok, despite the opposition of the Romanian 91st Regiment of the 18th Infantry Division. The attackers brought the entire 6th and 7th Divisions across the Tisza, formed up within the bridgehead, then attacked, overwhelming the Romanian troops in the first line of defense. The Hungarian 6th Infantry Division attacked to the east and took Torokszentmiklós, while the 7th Division advanced towards Mazodar. While this was happening, the 5th Division was brought over the Tisza and it attacked towards Turkiv on the 22nd of July. The Hungarians advanced towards Kunhegyes, after crossing the Tisza some 20 From the 3rd Romanian Line, including the 1st Infantry Division of Gen Obogianu in the center, the 6th Infantry Division under Gen Olteanu to the left and the 2nd Cavalry Division of Gen Davidolu to the right of the group, along the Tisa the Romanian counterattack. This section does not cite any sources. Please help improve this section by adding citations to reliable sources. Unsourced material may be challenged and removed. March 2012. Learn how and when to remove this template message. The Romanian maneuver group attacked on the morning of the 24th of July. Elements of the 2nd Cavalry Division, supported by troops of the 18th Infantry Division, took Cunhagis. The Romanian 1st Infantry Division attacked the Hungarian 6th Infantry Division head-on and pushed them back, managing to take Fegyvernik. The Romanian 6th Division was less successful, being counterattacked on the left flank by the Hungarian reserve formations in total. On the 24th of July, the Romanians managed to push the Hungarians back some 20. Violent on the front of the Romanian 1st Infantry Division, in and around Fegyvernik, where the Hungarians chose to counterattack towards the end of the day, the Romanians' maneuver group started breaking through the Hungarian positions in the north also. Hungarian positions in the south were overrun. The Hungarians started a general retreat towards the Tisza Bridge in front of Szolnok, which they blew up on the 26th of July in order to stop the Romanians from following them on the evening of the 26th of July. The entire east bank of the Tisza was again under firm Romanian control. The Romanians cross the Tisza. This section does not cite any sources. Please help improve this section by adding citations to reliable sources. Unsourced material may be challenged and removed. March 2012. Learn how and when to remove this template message. Troops from the 2nd Vanatory Division crossing the Tisza in the presence of King Ferdinand and Queen Marie. Romanian troops entering Budapest after repulsing the Hungarian attack. The Romanians started making plans to cross the Tisza in order to deliver the final blow to Soviet Hungary. Despite some opposition from the Allied Council, they brought the 7th Infantry Division back from the Bessarabian Front, where the Russians were holding still, and also brought along the 2nd Infantry Division as well as some smaller infantry and artillery units for crossing the Tisza. The Romanian command prepared 119 battalions with some 84,000 troops, 99 artillery batteries with 392 guns, and 60 cavalry squadrons with 12,000 men during the build-up. The Hungarians made efficient use of their artillery, attacking the Romanian concentration areas between 27 and the 29th of July. The Romanians tested the strength of the Hungarian defense with small attacks. They finally decided to cross the Tisza in the vicinity of Fegyvernik, where the river makes a turn on the night of 29th to the 30th of July. The Romanians crossed the Tisza. The main crossing at Fegyvernik was covered by decoy operations on other points of the front, where intense artillery duels took place. The Romanians managed to surprise the Hungarians at Fegyvernik, who then decided on the 31st of July to abandon the Tisza line and retreat towards Budapest. The debacle of the Hungarian army. This section does not cite any sources. Please help improve this section by adding citations to reliable sources. Unsourced material may be challenged and removed. March 2012. Learn how and when to remove this template message. After the bulk of the Romanian troops crossed the Tisza, they started advancing towards Budapest. The Romanian cavalry covered the flanks of the main body of troops and tried to discover the points of concentration of the Hungarian army. At the same time, it probed and severed the links between the different corps of the Hungarian army. On the 1st of August, most fighting took place in the south, in and around Szolnok. The town having been severely affected by the fighting at the end of the day, the Hungarians sent representatives to negotiate their surrender in the center and in the north. The Hungarian troops were completely surrounded by the evening of the 3rd of August, and the units start to surrender or to disintegrate. The 3rd of August saw the end of the Hungarian Red Army. The Romanians occupy Budapest. This section does not cite any sources. Please help improve this section by adding citations to reliable sources. Unsourced material may be challenged and removed. March 2012. Learn how and when to remove this template message. Romanian army in front of the Hungarian Parliament, Budapest, 1919. The Romanians continued their push towards Budapest. The first Romanian units to enter Budapest on the evening of the 3rd of August were three squadrons of the 6th Cavalry Regiment of the 4th Brigade. Under the command of Gen Rusescu, the 400 men with two artillery guns were the only forces to occupy the city until midday on 4 August, when the bulk of the Romanian forces entered Budapest and a parade took place through the center of the city in front of their commander, Gen Mosoiu, the Romanian troops continued their advance into Hungary until they stopped in Gyur. Casualties, prisoners and war booty. This section does not cite any sources. Please help improve this section by adding citations to reliable sources. Unsourced material may be challenged and removed. March 2012. Learn how and when to remove this template message. The third phase of the Hungarian-Romanian War saw the most intense fighting of the entire conflict. Total Romanian casualties were 123 officers and 6,434 soldiers, of which 39 officers and 1,730 soldiers dead, 81 officers and 3,125 soldiers wounded, and 3 officers and 1,579 soldiers missing in operations. Up until 8 August 1919, Romanian forces captured 1,235 officers and 40,000 soldiers, seized 350 guns, including 2 with a caliber of 305. Short-lived power was taken then by the counter-revolutionary White House Fraternal Association, trying to instate Archduke Joseph as head of state and István Friedrich as prime minister. However, the Allies would not accept a Habsburg as head of state, and hence a new government was needed. The Romanians occupied all Hungary, with the exception of a piece of land around the Lake Balaton. There, a group formed around Admiral Horthy, and supplied with arms by the Romanians, was organizing the new Hungarian army, preparing to take over after the Romanians would eventually leave. Horthy's supporters included some far-right nationalist elements, the semi-regular White Guards, who were the main perpetrators of persecutions, including violence, against former Bolsheviks and against the Jewish Hungarian population, whom they perceived as communist en masse. Due to the disproportionate participation of its members in the communist administration, this prompted Horthy's National Army and the Romanian troops to take steps towards protecting the Hungarian Jews. On the other hand, in the occupied territories, the Romanian troops also launched punitive actions against the revolutionaries. Initially, the Romanians also took over police and administration duties in the regions under their control. Later, under Entente pressure, they relinquished these tasks to the reorganized Hungarian administration and police, but obstructed them, for example by failing to return enough weapons to arm the police, as it happened in Budapest, where only 600 carbines were returned to arm 3,700 policemen. The Romanians took care of feeding the population of large Hungarian cities in the first month after the fighting ceased, as their supply infrastructure collapsed because of the war reparations or looting. The Entente was discontented with the Romanian conduct during much of its conflict with Hungary. The reason for this was that on many occasions Romania acted out of its own free will, following what it considered to be its best interest. However, in doing so it placed itself outside the framework the Entente tried to establish in its agreements with Hungary. The Entente was deeply displeased with the Romanians advancing up to the Tisza River during Phase 2 of the conflict, and even though happy to get rid of the Hungarian communists, it did not sanction the Romanian occupation of Hungary proper, nor the Romanians imposing war reparations and requisitioning these on their own. The Entente thought that Hungary should pay war reparations in common with the Central Powers, and pressured Romania to accept the supervision of an inter-allied military mission to superintend the disarmament of the Hungarian army and to see that the Romanian troops withdraw. Romanian soldiers feeding the civilian population in Hungary. Romanian infantry patrol in Budapest.